Can you hear me okay? It's really hard to follow cookies. I wanted to just thank you for inviting me. This is an opportunity for me to really reflect on my housing career because I actually come from counseling. And when I entered housing, ACUHO-I was all I had. I didn't have any training or anything that prepared me for what was coming. So what was mentioned is I am from New Brunswick, not New Jersey. It's directly north, northern New Brunswick, which is an Acadian area. I spoke French and English most of my life, my mom being French, my husband being from Toronto. I also lived across the country, as was mentioned. I got to go to the University of Vermont. Yeah, I knew they'd get a whoop. So I packed up my Chevette, that's what I drove, and did the 8-hour drive, and I ended up at that wonderful institution. So I was an international student in this wonderful country, and I think that really helps me understand what it could be like for international students, although how different is a Canadian from an American, really? Well, I found out kind of the hard way at the time, and I don't know if it's still like that, but Canadians didn't have to go to the international orientation sessions because I think there was an assumption we're very much the same. But I learned really quickly there were some things. I didn't wear Birkenstocks. I kind of looked the same. I spoke the same language, but it was a different currency. And I had to figure out some things in my life, like how to pay for rent. And it was the housing program that really helped me feel like I belonged. I was in the counseling program, and I was able to take an RA position. We're going to fast forward 15 years, or back 15 years, and when I joined the ACUHO-I exec board. At the time, we were talking about things like TPE, what would become TPE. We were talking about the changes in the committees, all these things that we saw come to fruition. And one of the things we talked about was ACUHO, ACUHO-I, or IACUHO. And I remember the conversations, and those of you who sat on the board, you might remember this at the time. We said, we can't drop the I. We're not ready for that. We're not ready for IACUHO either. So let's just stick to the hyphen. And hey, I'm okay with hyphens. my husband, yeah. And you know, I've heard it over the years. The hyphen feels like an add-on. Sometimes it's dropped, right? Sometimes we say ACUHO and we forget that there's the I. It's just part of, that's okay, right? And I'm not here to say that there's one right way or a wrong way, but I am here to kind of talk about, are we ready for maybe something different? And I think part of it is trying to take all the knowledge that we have and making sure that it's accessible and usable for everyone in the world. Kind of a big task. These are some of the students at my institution. I bet you can't pick out the Canadian. They're all Canadian. Exactly. So we get that question a lot, you know, side story, international students wanting to live with a Canadian, seeing the name and going, that's not Canadian, yeah, it's Canadian. So things have changed the past 20 years, 19 years that I've been in housing. We're not just citizens of the town, the state, the country. We've heard it already from some of our speakers. We are global citizens. We have to ensure that our competency around globalization and international, we have to be just more ready. This is just the way it is now. We have a lot of people, and our students are studying and traveling all over the world. Our government has made a big push for study abroad, so it's not just our bringing in our international students, but it's also sending them out to your institutions. It's about being, I guess, this is also about us as members and making sure that we feel welcome, but all of us being international and internationally minded, that it's beyond the diversities of the 8 diversities, the categories of gender and all those things, and thinking about nationality and citizenship. I think about the people who couldn't be here at this conference and the barriers that are put in place in today's world, and yet people are traveling and studying abroad and working. I've met Americans that are working abroad. This is just a completely different world than it was 20 years ago. It's an important time to think about what we're doing as an association and each of us and what we do at our institutions. And I don't have all the answers. I gave you a little bit quick story about my experience as an international student. Like I said, I didn't go anywhere too different. But it's one of those places where if we can be more internationally minded and more globally competent, we can change the experience of our students and our staff. And it starts at home. And where's home? It's with us. We're the ones that have that ability. I have seen the transformation. We've all seen the transformation that occurs when our students experience one another. The Northern BC student who's never seen anyone with a different skin color comes down to Vancouver, meets someone that they, you know, as a roommate, and all of a sudden they're studying abroad somewhere that they never even thought of before. It's about recognizing and also ensuring that we respect when we're using terminology or using programs that we really recognize where they come from, such as the style of presentation. This is a Japanese style of presentation. It comes from PechaKucha. So I guess my question to you at the end of all this is that how would you increase your global competency? How do you become more internationally minded? And I encourage you to tweet about it, because I'm looking for ideas. Sure, I can travel. Sure, I can do all these things, but I'd love to hear from you how you plan on increasing your global competency. That's just me. This is my thoughts, my story. I look forward to hearing from you about what you're going to do in your future and how you're going to change your experience, but I just want to say thank you for giving me the opportunity.